Hello and a big welcome to the Career Success Podcast. I'm Jason Connolly. If you're a regular listener, it's great to have you back. But if you're new, welcome to the show. In this series every week, we speak to the biggest names in business all across the globe. We talk about their career stories, the lessons learned, how they overcome challenges, and what success habits they practice. If you have a passion for business, then this is the podcast for you. In this episode, I'm joined by Daniella Genas from Birmingham. Daniella is a multi-award-winning strategy and innovation expert. Through her business, She's the Boss International, Daniella helps SMEs to transform their businesses. She has used her techniques, experience, and training to generate significant results amongst the companies that she has worked with. Key metrics include increased turnover and profits, increased staff, launch of new products and services, and increased brand awareness across several businesses in a diverse range of sectors. Daniella launched her first successful business in 2009 and her second business in 2014. She sold both businesses in 2015. In addition to her entrepreneurial endeavours, Daniella lists university lecturer, charity trustee, radio presenter, and visiting industry fellow as roles in her portfolio career. Daniella's current focus is empowering SMEs to build profitable, sustainable, systems-driven businesses. With an MBA and master's under her belt, alongside her entrepreneurial experience and formal business training, Daniella has a breadth of knowledge which has proven invaluable to clients that she works with. She has a proven track record of supporting clients to grow revenues by six figures. Daniella also hosts a weekly podcast series titled Female Entrepreneur Stories and interviews women in business, exploring their journeys and advice for success. Daniella, thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
Quite the introduction, Daniella, but tell us how it all got started for you and talk us through your career. It sounds really interesting.
So initially, the dream was to be a media mogul. So I was very much inspired growing up by Oprah Winfrey. And I was really excited about this idea of having my own TV show, having a magazine, having a production company. So I went to university to study media and communications. And at university, I specialized in television and radio production. And the kind of idea was, okay, I'm going to do this, I'm going to finish, and I'm going to start this kind of media agency. But it became quite clear early on that in order to really break into the media, I would need to move to London. I'd gone to university in Birmingham. I'm originally from Nottingham. And I was told quite consistently by lecturers and kind of media professionals that I'd have to move to London, I'd have to be a runner and make teas and coffees and work my way up. I come from a background that, I don't come from a background with lots of money. So I knew that I wasn't going to be able to kind of live for free whilst working for free, and decided actually that's not really the move that I'm going to be able to make. So I stayed in Birmingham. Before going to university, actually, when I was at college and kind of even when I started university, I realized that I had a real passion for events. So I was working whilst at college for an organization called Build Mentor Agency that did mentoring for young people, and they appointed me to organize some of their events. This was at like age 17, well, between 16, 17 and 18. And then when I went to university, I set up a society and was organizing events through there. So once I left university and realized, actually, I'm not moving to London. It was kind of like, well, what do I do now? I kind of flitted from job to job. So I tried working for around a year. And in that year, I had about five or six different jobs because I'd quit after a couple of months. And then I heard about a program being run by my former university called Inside Out. And it was basically a business startup program. So I decided, why not give that a try? I'm not happy with doing the work that I'm doing, so let me give this a whirl. And joined with the intention, actually, of setting up a talent agency and kind of event company for young people. Whilst on the program, a friend of mine from university was also on the program. She wanted to do an event management company. So we decided to team up, and we had two other friends from university who weren't on the program, but we'd kept in touch with, and they said that they wanted to join. So all four of us kind of started the business, and that is essentially how I got into entrepreneurship.
And that's quite, it sounded like you started that at a very young age.
Yes, I was 21.
And how did you get on with that business? What was your experience of kind of going through that journey at such a young age?
It was a learning journey, let's put it that way. We didn't have a clue what we was doing at all. We decided, okay, we're going to be in business. And we just thought, okay, once we have a company name and a logo and some laptops, that means we're in business. and that literally is how it went. Like, okay. So we went to the Prince's Trust and got a loan. And I always say it was probably one of the... I don't believe in having regrets because I think everything happens for a reason. But in hindsight, it wasn't really the best thing to do. Because we got this loan, we brought laptops and a printer, paid to get our logo done, but we didn't actually have a business model. We didn't have a business plan. We didn't have a clear understanding of what we were even trying to achieve. We just got really excited and said, we're entrepreneurs now, we're in business. And the cracks started to show relatively quickly. Within about, I don't know, about 16 to 18 months, each of the other three girls left the business. So, for different reasons, but basically because we didn't know what it was doing and we weren't necessarily getting on because we were realizing, actually, this is hard work and we don't know what we're doing. And I proceeded with keeping the business and pushing on. So although the business formed properly in 2009, we'd actually joined and started working together in 2007. So in 2009 is when I then registered it as a community interest company and kind of decided to go it alone. And quite quickly, I kind of formalized what the business model was going to be. I wanted to be a social enterprise. I wanted to do events, but I also wanted to provide training and development opportunities for young people, specifically those from disadvantaged backgrounds, because I came from a disadvantaged background. And I was able to secure some funding initially, which enabled me to get an office and take on my first staff member. And then I realized, actually, I'm quite good at this funding application thing. And I kept putting in applications. And before I knew it, we kind of were in, I'd say in inverted commas, were turning over six figures.
Wow.
Had about 8 members of staff, was running a variety of different projects. I was also quite good at sponsorship. So I was able to secure sponsorship from some really big brands, Subway, HMV, which was obviously a big brand at that time, Sony, BMG, Coca-Cola.
Wow.
And I was kind of living the dream. I was winning awards. I was invited to be part of a women's hour show like that kind of documented my business journey over a 12-month period. I was on BBC News. So at that point, I felt like, right, I've made it. I've arrived. And then I started to realize, actually, funding isn't classed as proper turnover. And realized that actually the business model wasn't sustainable. So then I started looking at how do I kind of build up the commercial side of the business, which was supposed to be corporate events. So the idea was the corporate events should pay for the training of the young people. And then the young people that we trained would then support the corporate events through performance, because the types of corporate events that we were supposed to be doing were celebration events. So Christmas parties, awards, networking events, that kind of thing.
And how did that go? What was it like building the commercial side?
It was really tough. It was really, really tough because we'd built such a strong reputation for the youth side. When we would approach the corporates, they would just automatically assume we were a charity. So they would say, oh, yeah, you can do our event for us. I assume that it's free. And I would be like, well, no, actually, we're an event management company. And then, oh, we thought you was a charity. So there was a real big disconnect between people understanding what a social enterprise was versus a charity. So we really struggled to kind of get the corporates to invest in our services, because a lot of the time they were just of the opinion that, number one, it's a charity, and number two, it's just loads of young people that don't really know what they're doing.
How would you describe a social enterprise?
So a social enterprise is a business that operates for more than profit. So there was this kind of phrase that people used to use quite a lot previously, not for profit. And actually, I think that's where the confusion came from, because not for profit sounds like a charity. Whereas a social enterprise is actually for more than profit. Social enterprises do exist to make a profit, but that profit is reinvested into the area of interest that they're focusing on. So that could be young people, it could be community, it could be the elderly, it could be the environment. So they're still businesses, but rather than the CEO or the founder taking home a big dividend check at the end of the year, any profits are reinvested into the outcomes that the business has kind of been formalized to focus on.
What made you want to do that? Because it's to have a business like that, it's very different. It sounds like it's, you know, a real thing that you're trying to kind of give back. What was the kind of motivation to get involved in this in the first place?
It was that, wanting to give back. So I think all businesses should be social enterprises.
I'm guessing at that stage you hadn't made your money and you hadn't kind of maybe paved the way of your own sort of future.
No, not at all.
So you were giving back before you'd even made yourself.
Yeah, and that's essentially what my mentor... So I was appointed a mentor with the Women's Hour series that I did, and I remember her very clearly saying, you're trying to help people before you've even helped yourself. And I always remember that being kind of like an aha light bulb moment in my head. But I think for me, I was just so passionate about supporting young people and being somebody that was quite motivational, quite entrepreneurial, quite aspirational, coming from an inner city background. I had always thought, had I been given more opportunities, how much further could I have made it? And therefore, can I provide those same opportunities for other young people who are coming from my kind of background? And that was really the motivation. But the challenge was, and the problem was, I wasn't really building the business. I was kind of building a series of funded projects. And then once I kind of worked that out and started to try and build the business, it's kind of like it was, I had done it back to front. I should have built the commercial side first and then started focusing on the kind of sociable side.
It's really interesting hearing your story as well, Daniella, because I grew up on a council estate in London. Mm-hmm. And school was the last place I wanted to be, more because of my own safety than anything else. And I was just kind of so desperate to get out there and kind of make money. I hear what you're saying in terms of sort of giving people opportunity. And that's kind of what I feel that I've done now. But I think it sounds like you learned a lot of lessons. You kind of went into this with a group of friends and then you were really out there kind of trying to navigate things alone, which is difficult. And, you know, huge respect to you, because that's not easy. Tell us more about how you kind of dealt with this commercial side of the business and how you, once you did identify that, hang on a minute, oh boy, we have a problem here. How did you go about fixing that? Because that sounds like a massive challenge in itself.
It was about learning. So I looked at, okay, where are my gaps in knowledge? So I recognized that kind of the formal business knowledge is one of the key areas I was lacking. I was not that great at being consistent with sales or developing sales strategies. And really, I kind of stayed within the comfort zone. So I knew that I could do funding applications. I knew I could do the kind of project development stuff. So I would say, okay, I'm going to do some sales this week. I'd make two or three phone calls. I wouldn't get a positive response. And then I would just revert back to what was comfortable. And I realized, actually, this is not productive. So I looked at how I could increase my knowledge. I applied for the Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Business Program and managed to get on, which was fantastic. And they call it like a mini MBA. And I did that and really enjoyed it, really learned a lot and kind of refined the business model from that, realized and recognized that I needed some investment, and then applied for the Unlimited Big Venture Challenge Program, which is an investment program for social entrepreneurs, and was able to secure a place on that. And identified how much investment I needed, what that was going to do for the business, managed to secure the investment. And then at the last minute, the investor said, actually, come back in 6 months. And if you hit this sales target that we've set for you, then we'll release the money. At that time, I was about 7 or 8 months pregnant.
Oh, wow.
And my mother was in, as I said, I live in Birmingham, but I'm from Nottingham. My mother was in Nottingham in intensive care. She suffered some kind of major health issue. So I was zipping up and down the motorway, and I just knew it wasn't going to be possible for me to hit that sales target. I'd gone from 8 members of staff at that point to 1. The remaining 1 member of staff, there was no way she was going to be able to do sales. She wasn't sales trained. And I then decided, okay, maybe it's time to call it quits. Somebody then made an offer to buy the business, and I sold it. It wasn't like a multi-million pound sale, but it was enough to kind of suffice through maternity leave. But it was a really devastating time for me, because I'd kind of wrapped up my whole life in the vision that I had for this business. I wanted to be like an international organization. I wanted to have different branches in different places in the world that trained young people, also organized these kind of phenomenal events. And it was all gone.
How did you internally deal with that? Because that must have been tough at the time. And how did you pick yourself back up to kind of move on from there?
Well, because I'd been on the Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Business Program, I was able to get a scholarship to do my MBA. So I had my daughter in July, sold the business in August, and started my MBA in September. So how did I get through it? It was just throw myself into studying and being a new mom and just try to ignore it. But it was a period of grief, because I would, like, there'd be times and I'd just be like, I cannot believe that this has happened. And as I said, because a lot of my identity was very much wrapped up in this Daniella Genas, she's an entrepreneur, award-winning social entrepreneur, making all this difference in the lives of all these young people. And also even just hearing from the young people themselves coming and saying, you've changed my life because of this program. I'm now going to university. I've now started a business. And then all that being gone, and I'm just like, oh, now I'm just a mom and I'm a student again. Like, it was really demoralizing. And I had to process it and actually recognize that everything isn't about that business. You can still be an entrepreneur. You can still make an impact. What are the lessons that were learned? And that is what I really spent a lot of time interrogating. Where did I go wrong? What were the key mistakes that I made? What would have happened if I had done X, Y, and Z? And really, also, as I said, throwing myself into the MBA. The MBA was really useful as well in helping me identify the kind of key areas that I should have been focusing on and building up my knowledge.
What were the lessons that you learned?
Oh, so many. Number one, don't go into business with friends without a contract. That's the first thing.
Yeah. I made the same mistake. I've been there, done that, worn that t-shirt.
Yeah, that's the first thing. Again, as you kind of alluded to, there's no point giving back before you've built yourself up. And I think that was something. Like, I don't regret it. I think that's what needed to happen to get me to this point. But if I was advising somebody else now, I would always focus on, you need to build up your commercial revenues. And that doesn't mean you can't be a social enterprise, but even social enterprises need to have the enterprise bit sorted before they're wholeheartedly focusing on the social bit. So that was definitely a big lesson. And then more of the business specific things, make sure that you have a clearly defined vision, make sure that you have systems and processes so that the business is not reliant on you. They should all be documented. Look at what can be automated. I wasn't that great with recruitment. So some of the kind of key lessons I learned were around how to recruit effectively, how to manage effectively, which is something that I didn't really do much learning on. I just kind of took on the staff and tried to work it out.
So did I.
Yeah, and then so many different problems happen.
Yeah.
Firing at least two people, which was a very unpleasant situation. Intellectual property is another thing. I didn't protect my intellectual property properly. So I had two occasions where my IP was stolen. Once by a member of staff, once by a member of a council in the UK.
Oh, wow.
So I say now, there's not many business scenarios that you can throw at me that I haven't really experienced, because I've experienced a lot. But some of the biggest lessons, yeah, are around not building a business that is reliant on you as the founder.
And it's through, I always think myself, even, it's through learning these kind of mistakes that I've learned along the way. And I wouldn't define them as mistakes anymore. I would define it as kind of lessons learned. Mm-hmm. And it's through learning all these. The only reason I've become successful, I think, ultimately, is the ability to get back up after a mistake and learn from it. And it sounds very like a kind of similar experience that you've kind of had. To kind of move on and talk about the second business that you started in 2014. Tell us about that, Daniella.
So that I kind of call that the in-between business, because I wasn't running it for that long.
Right.
So I got married in 2013. I am of Jamaican background. My husband is of Nigerian background. And we had major challenges trying to find wedding venues and wedding suppliers that could accommodate our kind of two different cultures. And it was really quite frustrating. So I kind of blogged about it, did online videos about it, and found that there was quite a few people that were having cross-cultural weddings, or that had cross-cultural weddings, that were struggling with the same issue.
What is the issue with it? Is it the venue or was it the...
So with so many different cultures, food is a significant and major part of celebrations. And lots of the nice venues say that you have to use their catering companies, their on-site caterers. Most of the on-site caterers can't accommodate for culturally specific food. So it just turns into a bit of a nightmare. Furthermore, a lot of the caterers that can cater for the cultural food only cater for one specific type of food. So I could find a Caribbean caterer and I could find a Nigerian caterer, but I couldn't find a caterer that could do both. So there was a variety of
my goodness, and I've been to both those places when I was a Virgin cabin crew, and it's different. It's the food is different.
Yeah, it's very different, and that was the challenge we had. We'd go to venues, and they'd be like, "Oh, but isn't it the same kind of food?" And I'd be like, "No, it's completely different." And even if we wanted one or the other, oh, it was like, "Well, actually, you can only use our caterers." So it was quite frustrating. So I teamed up with who would be my chair of the board for my previous business. His name is Trucio Powell. He was really, really experienced in event management and also had some similar challenges when organizing his own wedding. So we decided to team up and create a company that organized alternative weddings. So alternative being cross-cultural.
There's a big market for that.
Specific. Yeah, I think we were a little bit ahead of our time, to be honest. And also then, because I was having the baby, after I'd had my daughter, I was like, do I really want to go to wedding fairs every Sunday? Not really. So he continued the business. He brought me out and then he continued it and added a corporate element. And he still is running that business to this day. And funnily enough, he then became my client for my third business.
Oh, wow. And talk to us about the third business.
So the third business is the one I'm running now. She's the Boss International. Uh-huh. And I originally started it actually in 2017, but really just kind of as something to do whilst I was finishing off my MBA. I was doing kind of freelance kind of consultancy, a bit of coaching. And the idea was me trying to work out whilst I was doing my dissertation for my MBA, what kind of services I could provide to give entrepreneurs that I suppose were looking for support in a similar way to how I had been looking for support when I was in my first business, but unable to find the right type of support. So one of the issues I had is it was always one or the other. It was either somebody that was really academic, so they had a master's or they had an MBA, but didn't have any experience of running a business. So they could tell me frameworks, etc. But if I asked about day-to-day things in a business, they didn't have any experience of that. The alternative would be the career coaches, the career coaches were kind of those kind of people, so they've got the education. But then the other bit would be the entrepreneurs and the business owners who would kind of provide mentoring support because they were used to running a business. But then when I would try to understand kind of frameworks and ways of doing things, it was kind of like, well, I just worked it out as I went along. So I kind of decided I wanted to be that bridge that kind of had the academic experience and background, but also had the lived experience of running a business to provide the kind of support that I felt that I had needed and wasn't able to access.
It's interesting that you kind of categorize it in those two ways. I'm very much no academics, but more hands-on experience than I could possibly imagine through the probably the school of hard knocks. And kind of what I love the title, She's the Boss International. Tell us what was the kind of thought process behind that.
So there's two things. So when I actually initially started in 2017, it was Genas Enterprise Consultants, so very self-indulgent.
Very different to She's the Boss.
Yeah, really, it was just, how can I incorporate my name into something? And then I finished my MBA in 2018, and then I kind of rebranded in 2019. So as part of the MBA dissertation process, I started to do research around female entrepreneurship. So my dissertation was a business plan for the business, as well as kind of a literature review around female entrepreneurship and barriers to female entrepreneurship and growth of female-led businesses. So I started to interview women in business to try and obviously understand the barriers. And I think it was probably the first interview that I did. I kind of got to the end and I said, this is really interesting. And actually, I think this is something that other people would want to hear. So I asked the lady that I was interviewing, would you mind if I shared this on YouTube? And she said, yeah, that's fine. And then I started asking each subsequent interviewee the same thing. Would you mind if I shared it? And they said, yes. And I was kind of like, well, what could be a cool name for this? She's the boss. So I started the YouTube kind of series under the banner She's the Boss while still kind of doing the consultancy under Genas EC. And then when I decided in 2019, okay, I'm going to do this properly now. I'm really going to give it my all because I'd graduated from my MBA. My daughter had gone into full-time nursery. Well, she's gone into school actually by that point. And I said, okay, I'm going to do this for real now. What should I call the, what do I need to stay as Genas Enterprise Consultants? Probably not. It's not really working. It doesn't say anything. It's not really powerful. And it's funny, when I was running my first business, one of my staff members used to always call me the boss. And he'd introduce me to people. And they would say, oh, hi, I'm Nathan. This is world boss. She's the boss. And people would just start to call me the boss lady. So I was like, actually, it kind of makes sense that I just call the business She's the Boss. But I really wanted to maintain that international element because the vision still is for me to have a business that operates internationally. So that's why it's She's the Boss International. I moved away from focusing on just women. So I have both male and female clients, but the premise of the business is essentially the same. So it's, again, looking at it's kind of incorporating the lessons that I learned from my first business. Also, all of the research that I did on my MBA. I also have a master's in enterprise. So the research that I use for the master's dissertation, all of the stuff I learned from the Goldman Sachs program and from the Unlimited program, and have created a framework to kind of support businesses to grow and to not be founder reliant.
I know, and I've got a few questions I specifically want to ask you, and I'm conscious of time, Daniella. One thing I want to ask you, so you host a weekly podcast series titled Female Entrepreneur Stories, as I said when we introduced you at the start of the show. Mm-hmm. What do you tend to find? Is there kind of a common thread that seems to be one of the typical barriers that women face? What is it that you've tended to find through your research, interviews and podcast?
Imposter syndrome.
Tell us about that.
Well, in fact, there's two: imposter syndrome and burnout. Pretty much, I've had 100 guests now.
Wow.
100 guests. And when I also add the research that I did previously, because it wasn't just the interviews, I also did surveys and focus groups. And I did, I think I worked with about 300 entrepreneurs at that point. Mm-hmm. And again, imposter syndrome and burnout were two things that continually came up and has continually come up with the podcast series. A lot of women don't believe that they can achieve, and this is obviously all anecdotal, it's not for every single person, but many, I find, much more than kind of the male clients that I interact with, speak about not feeling good enough, not thinking that they can achieve a kind of high level of success, kind of wanting to stay more in this kind of six figure bracket as opposed to trying to aspire or aim for seven figures, wanting to not necessarily feeling comfortable with being called an entrepreneur or being called a success. So that's kind of the imposter syndrome bit, and then the burnout bit. So kind of working too hard and burning themselves out. The amount of interviews I've had where the women have consistently every single week, I had burnout. I couldn't get out of bed. I lost my voice. I couldn't work for a month. I was bedbound. I developed fibromyalgia. And that's something that has really kind of concerned me, actually, and also fits in with this kind of my ideals of not building a business that is founder reliant. That's one of the reasons, because if you do, it can lead to burnout. And burnout, I think, is a phrase that kind of gets bandied about and people don't necessarily take as seriously as they should, because if you persistently get burnout, it can lead to lifetime ailments such as ME and fibromyalgia. So that is one of the kind of, because of this repetitive or continuation of people saying this, I've really tried to push my messaging through the business and how I support businesses around making sure that you're kind of building a business that's reliant on systems and processes as opposed to you working every hour that God sends.
And I couldn't agree more with you, especially in terms of being founder reliant. I I got burnout myself, and I ended up getting psychosis 2 years into running my business, and was so sick. So I can definitely relate to that. I wanted to ask you, so you've become over the years, it sounds like to me, an absolute expert in applications, whether it be funding applications or applications in some way to get onto obviously the Goldman Sachs course and whatnot. What mm-hmm. advice would you give to someone, maybe kind of they've got an application, or they've just realized there's a grant out there, or there's something that could help their business? What is it that you've done that's allowed you to constantly win these applications and these tenders?
Focus on what the other person or the other party wants, not on what you want. And that really is the biggest piece of advice I can give. A lot of the time when I speak to clients, they speak about what they can do, what they want to do, how whatever it is going to be beneficial to them, as opposed to making sure that they're looking at what the other party requires and ensuring that they're answering the questions in relation to what the other party requires. I say quite often, and one of the key kind of messages that I share quite often is about being customer or client focused as opposed to business focused. And customer or client could be a funding body, it could be a sponsor, it could be the program manager, but focus on the customer or the client or the beneficiary, not on you or the business. So often I'll speak to clients, for example, and say, okay, why should somebody buy from you, or why should somebody invest in your business? And they will focus on the kind of the specific things that they do. And it's very business focused, like we provide, I don't know, this service, as opposed to the outcome or the benefit of that service for the end user, the client, the beneficiary. And I think what I've always been very good at doing is focusing on the other party. So, okay, I want this funding. These are the outcomes and the objectives that they want. I need to make sure that I am speaking about those outcomes and objectives and not getting caught up in these are the finer points and the minutiae of what I want to do and why I want to do it. They don't care about that. One of the things I always say to my clients is, so what? Whatever they say, so what? So what? And keep, it's quite irritating at times, I'm sure. But they will say something and I'll say, so what? They'll say something else, so what? And keep drilling down until we get to the point of what you're trying to say and why that's useful for, whether it's, again, the person that you're trying to sell to, whether it's the person you're trying to get to invest in your business, or whether it's a funder. You need to focus on them and not on you.
And I think that's really good advice, Daniella. I just wanted to ask you, tell us briefly about the Visa model. It's something that you've created, mm-hmm. and it's helped several of your clients to grow their business by six figures.
Mm-hmm. So the Visa model came out of a combination of my MBA research and also kind of the first year of the She's the Boss business. So this is after the Genas Enterprise Consultants. The She's the Boss business being operational. And also I work with an organization on a part-time contract providing business support. And through those kind of three methods, I kind of looked at what are the key fundamental elements that define a successful business and a business that is able to grow versus a business that remains stagnant. And I developed a few kind of different frameworks and methodologies and tested them and found that the kind of key determinants of success in terms of growth fit into the Visa model. So first is vision, having a compelling vision that provides direction for the individual and the organization if they've got team members. But making sure that vision is a compelling one, is documented, it's checked regularly. So I developed something called Vision 20, which is a half-day intervention where I support businesses and entrepreneurs to create a three-year vision for their business, which includes kind of goal setting, action planning, strategy, etc. And that is kind of one of my most successful services. And then innovation. So I looked at, okay, again, which of the businesses that I've been supporting are really making inroads in terms of growth. It's those that are innovative, those that look at developing new products or services, innovate their business model, innovate how they do things from a systems and processes perspective. So that was the second element. Systems and processes, so making sure that the business isn't reliant on everything in the founder's head or key members of staff. Businesses that really spend time on documenting and mapping and selecting the right systems, but also mapping processes, creating operations manuals, automating things, focusing on efficiency and quality are the businesses that do well and are able to scale, because then they're able to onboard staff quite quickly, they're able to delegate, and quality standards don't drop. Strategy, obviously, is another one. So businesses that spend time looking at how to engage with their kind of target market, what's going on in the kind of environment outside of their business, looking at their core competencies within their business and how they can maximize those to get to new markets or introduce new products and services through innovation. But then the final key part I found was businesses can do all of the above, but or know that they need to do all the above, but without accountability, a lot of the time, business owners don't necessarily do what needs to be done. They know what needs to be done, but they end up working too much in the business and not on the business.
Like a rabbit getting lost in the headlights.
Yeah, basically. And you can have these businesses and they're like, I've got all these ideas, but they haven't actually moved forward with any of them because they're just busy. I would say more than the rabbit in the headlights, hamster wheel. They're just going on this wheel and they need to get off, but they just can't stop. So providing accountability through a variety of different methods, I found really makes a significant and substantial difference. And not just accountability of, have you done this? It's also having that kind of that voice that comes in and kind of support. Okay, if this hasn't been done, what is the reason? What is the barrier? What's blocking this from happening? And I found that by implementing all five elements with my clients, they fly. So my kind of biggest success story, one of the clients that I've been working with since 2019, Neo Enterprise, and I've taken them through that visa model. They were turning over £15,000 in 2019. And at the last check, they were doing 700 and something thousand pounds turnover this year. And they're projected to do 1.3 million by next year.
Wow. And I think we could have spent the whole half an hour just talking about the visa model. And it's absolutely fascinating. I'm totally aware that we've ran up way over, but I think there's so much we could talk about, and your story and kind of anecdotes and all the listens that you've learned along the way are absolutely fascinating. I've got one last question, Daniella. So you grew up with your background, kind of, you know, you mentioned at the start of the show that it was kind of unprivileged, and that was a big part of kind of, you know, your story at the beginning. What advice would you give to someone right now who perhaps is the underdog, someone that's maybe living in an unprivileged area, and, you know, they really want to get that kind of foot on the ladder and propel themselves forward, but, you know, they haven't got all maybe all the tools at their disposal that someone else might have as well. What would you say to that person?
So my mantra for my business is the advice that I give to everyone, and that's think big, take action, keep pushing. And what does that mean in practical terms? Think big. Often when you come from a kind of deprived or underprivileged background, you're taught to think small. You don't allow yourself to think outside of your current circumstances because you can't achieve that. Again, imposter syndrome comes in. Think big, allow yourself to have really big aspirations. And I love the phrase, if you aim for the moon, you'll reach the stars. And I think it's really important that people that are starting off from a position of perceived disadvantage understand that those things don't have to stop them from achieving great success. But thinking alone is not going to do it. So take action. Be very strategic with the actions that you take. Taking action also means finding, if you don't have the knowledge, if you don't have access, find the people that do and network with them. Take action by being proactive. Don't wait for these things to happen to you or for you. And then finally... Finally, the keep pushing bit. You're going to face obstacles, and particularly if you're kind of trying to do these things with limited resources, limited knowledge, you're going to face obstacles. As I've said, I've faced many. And the important thing is that you are able to learn from those mistakes and keep pushing forward and not giving up.
Such great advice. I love it, Daniella. If people want to find out more about you, She's the Boss International, or they want to connect with you, where can they go to?
So they can visit my website, which is www.shesthebossintl.com. And I've got my brochure on there, list of all my services. But if you want to kind of connect with me in real life terms, Instagram is normally the place I spend most of my time, which is at shesthebossuk. And I'm also on LinkedIn, Daniella Genas.
Daniella, thank you so much. It's been such an insightful 40 minutes. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for having me.
That was Daniella Genas from Birmingham, from She's the Boss International. I'm Jason Connolly. This is the Career Success Podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, goodbye.